Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
And welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
And I'm Laura Drake. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
And here's how the show works. There's teachers from Dallas Teachers standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
Now, if you'd like help with your homework, call Dial a Teacher free at 888-986-2345.
Now, you can also send your comments on our website. Just go to homeworkhotline.org, click on the Yak Back button, and send in your comments.
Okay, it's Thursday. You know what that means. It's time for tonight's science challenge.
All right, I'm actually going to the board just talk a little bit about tonight's science challenge because we're going to incorporate math, your favorite, into it. So let me go back to this. Okay, you do coordinate geometry. We got our x and y axis. So I'm going to label these. All right, so this horizontal one is our x axis, right?
Yep.
Double check with the math teacher. All right. And our vertical is the y axis, right?
Yes. Correct.
And, doesn't look like an S, does it? But you can identify any of these points on here using those two axes, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's very similar. What I thought we'd do is compare it to the globe. If we look on the globe, we also have lines that go horizontally and vertically, all right? And this point here, Laura, is called our origin, right?
Correct.
That's the 0, 0 point.
Mm-hmm.
And so my question tonight would be, if I was at this 0, 0 point or the origin on the globe, where would I be, and what's the name of those two lines that make up the x and y axis on the globe?
Mm.
All right.
Okay, so again, for our science challenge tonight, you are gonna figure out what you're gonna look at the globe, and you're gonna do what corresponds to the x and y axis on the graph. So if you think you can solve the science challenge, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904, or you can just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly, and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
Well, remember, every correct response we add at our Hotline Hall of Fame, and if for enough points, you can win that tablet at the end of the season.
I love that problem.
It's because we brought some math in.
Yeah, I love it. That's a great one.
But, you know, they're related.
I'm trying to figure out the answer already. I'm like, oh, okay. All right.
All right. I think you have a problem for us.
A problem. I'm going to go to board. We had a caller from New York City who did not want to be on, but I'm going to still go to the problem because it's a great problem.
Okay.
And a couple of kids had it. All right. So our problem is Callista is making fruit baskets for her service group. She was told to put 5 apples for every 6 oranges. She put 2 apples for every 3 oranges in her basket. We need to make a chart showing the equivalent ratios for 5, 6 and another for 2 to 3. And if she has 12 oranges, will she have enough apples in her basket? Okay. So that should be a little mistake there. That should be enough in her basket. Okay, so now as we go to look at this problem, we need to figure out what is it that we are really being asked to do. Okay, so whenever you have these big lengthy word problems, don't dive in. First, we're going to take it apart. So first I'm going to think is, what is my task? What do I need to do? When will I know I'm done with this problem? So when I look through this problem, I know that I will be done when I made a chart with equivalent ratios for 5 to 6 and for 2 to 3. And then I also know that I'll be done is when I can answer the question, will she have enough apples in her basket? Okay? So those are the really important parts that we have. Now, the things that support that, I go back again and I look for my data. Like, what numbers in here, what things are going to help me solve this problem? And I see she's going to put 5 apples for every 6 oranges. And in my head, I'm like, I'm thinking a ratio. This is a ratio. And she's also going to put 2 apples for every 3 oranges into her basket, okay? So that's the data that we're gonna use to answer this question. So now let's do it. It says, so make a chart showing equivalent ratios. So when we go to make a chart, we're gonna do a chart for 5, 6, and for 2, 3. So there's 5, 6, and we'll do this one for 2, 3. So when we do 5, 6, we need to think about this. What is five and what is six? What is five standing for? So five is standing for our apples, and six is standing for our oranges. So what that means is she was told every time you take five apples, you're going to need to throw six oranges in. So, and then she can still take more. She can take another five, but that means she's going to need another six oranges and another five and another six. So that's what she was told to do, but she didn't do that. She decided, hey, I'm going to try pick up every two apples and pull in three apples. So we're going to figure out, is that okay? Will she still have enough when she's done? So when we look at this, we have five and six, and we want to create a table. We want to have a few numbers in there so that we can compare them, because we don't know whether she's going to have enough. We're going to take a look at some numbers. So the first time she grabs five apples, she puts six oranges in. So let's say she grabs another five apples. Well, how many apples is she going to have? Well, she had five. She added five more, so now she's going to have 10. But if she took five more apples, she had to also take six more oranges. So we're going to add another six to the bottom here, and so that she is going to have 12. All right, we want to have about four pairs of numbers in our table, so I'm just going to keep going. I know that she's going to take another five apples, so if she had 10, she's now going to have 15. And she's going to take another six oranges, so that's going to be 18. And just for good measure, one more. We're going to add five more onto the 15, and we're going to have 20. And 6 plus another 18 is 24. I'm not sure if that's enough, but I usually know if I do 3 or 4, that'll get me started. I might have to come back and add some more to my table, okay? Now we're going to do the other ratio. The second ratio is 2 to 3, okay? So we're going to put the 2 in the 3 table, and the 2 again stands for our apples, and the 3 stands for our oranges. Okay, same thing's gonna happen. For every two apples that she takes, she's gotta grab three oranges. So if she took two and then she grabs two more, she's gonna be at 4, but she's gonna grab three more oranges, so she's gonna be at 6. She's gonna grab two more apples, 4 plus 2 will bring her to 6, and then she's gonna add three more oranges, which will bring her to 9. She's gonna add two more apples, which will bring her to 8, and three more apples, which will bring her to 12. All right, I've got a table so that I can compare my ratios. So look at this. Make a chart showing equivalent ratios for 5, 6, and another for 2, 3. Done. These are all equivalent. Something's in the ratio of 5 to 6. 5 to 6 is the exact same thing as a ratio of 10 to 12. So that's what they mean by equivalent. If you reduce them, they would all go back down to 5, 6. Every number on the top is a multiple of 5. Every number on the bottom is a multiple of 6. Same thing with this one. Everything on the top is a multiple of 2, and everything on the bottom is a multiple of 3. All right, so now as we go on, the last question that we have to ask, if she has 12 oranges, will she have enough apples in her basket? All right, 12 oranges. So I'm going to look at my table. I see 12 oranges right there, okay? So according to the recipe or whatever she was told, that needs to be 5 to 6. If she got 12 oranges, she is going to need 10 apples, okay? So let's come down here. What she actually got was when she got 12 oranges, she only got 8 apples. Womp, womp, she did not have enough apples in her basket. We're gonna say no, she only has 8. And so that is how we use a ratio table to help us out to solve a real life world problem.
I said, hey, hey.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
All right, so we'll get back to the questions in just a minute.
But first, we're getting a lot of close answers, okay?
Okay, close.
We said we were looking for the names of the two lines that would represent the X and Y axis. So I'm not looking at what all these vertical lines are called and what all the horizontal lines are called, but those two in particular that would make up the X and Y axis. So if you went to the origin on the globe, where the 0, 0 point, what would be the name of those two lines that would intersect there, all right?
Okay. All right, so we are going to go, let's take a look at this week's Hotline book review, so check it out.
Hi, I'm Victoria, and I read the book Percy Jackson and the Olympians, The Lightning Thief. Percy Jackson is a sixth grade boy with ADHD and dyslexia. His life is pretty normal, or so he thinks. At first, he takes a field trip to a Greek museum with his class, and all of a sudden, his algebra teacher turns into a monster called a fury. After this event, nobody can recall having an algebra teacher named Mrs. Dodds. This is just the start of Percy's problems. Afterwards, Percy realizes that his life has completely changed. He finds out he is a demigod, a half-human and half-god person. His father mysteriously disappeared a long time ago, and now Percy knows exactly why. Soon after, he is accused of stealing Zeus's master lightning bolt. He must go on a quest with his best friends Annabeth and Grover to retrieve the lightning bolt and prove that he is innocent. I would recommend Percy Jackson and the Olympians, The Lightning Thief by Rick Riordan, for anyone who is interested in Greek mythology and fantasy. I can guarantee that you will love this book and all the other books in the series.
Hi, I'm Ariana, and I read the book Three Good Deeds by Vivian Van De Velde. Howard is a boy from Dufferinville. He has two best friends named Roscoe and Lana. Howard is known to be a troublemaker. Step into the story and learn how Howard was turned into a goose. One day in Dufferinville, Howard went to pay a visit to the goose pond near an old lady's house. Howard thought it would be funny to steal some of the eggs from the pond. Just as Howard was about to leave, the old lady caught him and yelled at him, causing him to drop the eggs. The old lady became furious, and little did Howard know, but she was a witch. In a matter of seconds, Howard went from a human boy to a goose. In order for Howard to become a boy again, he would have to do three good deeds. Some time passed, and Howard only had performed two good deeds. It was now spring. Howard tried very hard to do simple things, hoping it would be good enough for the third deed, which he had not accomplished yet. Spring turned into summer, and Howard had still not completed his third deed. Summer turned into fall, and the geese started to get ready to migrate to the south. Howard decided to stay with the old lady. Later on the same day, the old lady passed out and died. Howard decided it would be nice to help the old lady and bury her. What else could he do for her? He was able to bury her in a hole that he had dug. Howard began to think, if she's dead, how will I become a boy again? His question was answered. After a few seconds, his thoughts of becoming human again were interrupted by the witch who had put the spell on him. She said that he had performed three good deeds. I enjoyed reading this book. I would recommend it to anyone who likes reading fantasy books.
Hi, I'm Hannah, and I'm going to tell you about the book Matilda. Matilda is a child genius living with her non-intelligent family. Her parents hate her, and so does her brother. Matilda loves to drive them insane with crazy antics and her superhuman powers. Matilda excels at reading all of the books in the library, solving equations like a calculator, and all other subjects. But when this smart cookie is sent to Crunchham Hall Primary School, she is in for more magic involving the kid-hating, massive anger-head mistress, Miss Trunchbull. Matilda has fun torturing her mean principal and makes some friends along the way, including Matilda's sweet teacher, Miss Honey. Matilda uses her powers not just for chaos, but maybe the greatest magic Matilda could wish for. Read Matilda by Roald Dahl today. I liked Matilda because of how she can deal with her situations. Since she's a genius, that makes everything all the better. Roald Dahl has a great read for the world, so read Matilda today. I hope you like Matilda as much as I do.
They do a great job, don't they?
They sure do.
You know, the only ones I recognize are, I know my kids read the Percy Jackson series, and they really like them.
You said you read those, did you?
I did. I read all of them. They're great. They're really interesting. They capture your interest. And they're great, especially if you really don't like reading. They will hook you in, and they will make you a reader. So
that's great.
That's a great Christmas thing to ask for.
All right. Now, if you want to see this video again or others like it, remember, you can go to our website, go to homeworkhotline.org, and click on videos. All right, now we have another one of those calls. We had a shy caller, didn't want to be on.
Everybody's shy
sent,
today.
Sent a great call, so I'm going to go to the board and work this one out too. And what we have here is this person said, apples cost $3 for 2 pounds. And it's a two-part question. The first one says, how many pounds will she have if she buys $9 worth of apples? So I think we're going to solve this one by proportions. All right, we know that 2 pounds, I'll use the LBS abbreviation, would cost us $3. All right, we want to know if she buys $9 worth, what what will be the number of pounds, what will be the amount of apples she gets. So we can solve this by cross multiplying. We're going to get 3, I'm going to drop the dollar signs for now, x equal to 2 times 9, which would be 18, okay? Now, excuse me, if we divide both sides by 3, I'm going to divide this side by 3 and this side by 3, and come over here where I have more room, x would be equal to, because 3 divided by 3, any number divided by itself is 1, 1 times x is x, and 8 divided by 3 will be 6, all right? Now, the unit that I'm going to have is the unit we had up here. It's going to be 6 pounds, all right? So if 2 pounds cost $3, whoops, all right, we spend $9, we should get 3 times that amount, or 6 pounds. And we're going to need that to look at the second part of our answer. And it says if one apple weighs 5 ounces, how many apples will you have if you buy $9 worth of apples? Now, this is kind of tricky, because up here we figured out that if we use $9 worth, we're going to have 6 pounds of apples. But they're not giving us pounds, they're giving us ounces. So we kind of have a two-step process here. We need to know what would 6 pounds of apples be in ounces, and then we can use our 5 ounces per apple to get us how many apples we have. So first we got to know conversion here. We need to know that there's 16 ounces in 1 pound. If we have 6 pounds, that means we're going to have 6 times that amount, or 6 times 16, excuse me, ounces would give us what we're looking for. Now later on when you get to physics, you're going to work on a way of making sure that all your units would cancel, but right now we're just going to do the numbers. So 6 times 16, all right, and I'll pull up our calculator, we might as well do this together. 6 times 16 equals 96. All right, so 96, now remember, is in ounces. 6 pounds, 16 ounces per pound, gives us 96 ounces. The question was, if one apple weighs 5 ounces, how many apples would they get? So what we have to do now is divide our number of ounces by 5. Each apple has a mass of weight of 5 ounces. So we could take our answer here and divide it by 5. And what we're going to get is an answer of 19.2 apples. Now, can we have 19.2 apples? I guess we could take a slice out of one, but I'm sure that's not what we're looking at. So we'd have to round this off, and I think the correct answer here would be 19 apples. All right, we can't take the 0.2. But remember, when you get questions like this, work them through step by step, and later on you'll get to the point where you gotta make sure your units cancel so you know you're doing the right thing. But once you think this one through, it's not as difficult a problem as it may have looked like at the beginning.
I said, hey. When dividing two fractions, find the reciprocal of the second fraction. Then multiply the fractions together to get your answer.
You have a question you're going to do?
I do. I have a question from my math class today that I said that I would do on the board. Somebody needed help after school, and I said, I got to go. I got to be on TV. Watch the show. So I'm going to come on over here.
Great.
The question involved a shape, and it involved a shape called a parallelogram. And just as a quick review, a parallelogram is a four-sided figure where the two opposite sides are parallel to each other and has two sets of parallel sides. So when I look at this thing, it's got a few numbers on it. I know the bottom, the base here is 15 meters, and I know the slanty part here is 6 meters. And there's also another number on here, which is 5 meters. And so the question that we had to work on today is, what is the area and what is the perimeter of this parallelogram? So we want to know, what is the area and what is the perimeter? And I might be doing it in a crazy order, but I really want to do the perimeter first because I just personally find the perimeter a lot easier to do, and I'm going to start with the perimeter, even though we have to find them both. So I look at this problem, and I see that the bottom is 15. I know that they're parallel equal sides. So that lets me know that if the bottom is 15, then I can change the top number to 15 as well. They're parallel, they have equal distance. That's the definition of a parallelogram. So that lets me know that if this is 15, that's 15. If this slanty side here, the diagonal is 6, I know that this side is 6. So the thing that kind of we got caught up on a little bit today is when you have to find the perimeter would be the outside. I always just kind of think like if you were going to put a fence or put a frame around it, it would go around the edges. So this was tripping people up. They saw this dotted line here and they weren't sure. So we really need to think about it. The perimeter is going around the outside. So our perimeter is really just talking about the whole outside here, okay? So I'm going around and it's the whole outside here. So when I'm going to find the perimeter, I just have to add all those pieces. So I have 6 and 6 and 15 and 15. A whole bunch of people do it a whole bunch of different ways. We can do 2 times 6 if we want, plus 2 times 15. And we know that 2 times 6 is 12. 2 times 15 is 30. That the perimeter of this shape is going to be 32, and it's going to be meters. That's how we label it. We go back and we look at it. And it's linear, which means we don't have to add any of those squares or crazy stuff on it. So my perimeter is going to be 32 meters. 12 plus 30 is going to be 42. Whoop, forgot to carry a 10. My perimeter is going to be 42. All right, so now we're going to take a look and we're going to look at the area. So when we go to look at the area of a rectangle is like the length times width, but this is not a rectangle. This is a parallelogram. So the formula for the area of a parallelogram is the base times the height, okay? So our formula for that area is equal to the base times the height. And that is where our dotted line comes into play. This 6 is not the height. Think about it. Like if you had a wall or the side of a cardboard box and you squished it down, it wouldn't still stand up 6 feet tall. You've kind of knocked it down on its side. So the same thing happens over here. That's why the height is 5. So if we're going to multiply this, we're going to multiply the base times the height. And just to kind of make more sense of that for some people, if I was to cut this off right here and then take it and float it right over here, see what it makes? It makes a rectangle. And we said that the formula for a rectangle was the length times the width. So that formula kind of makes sense. So we're going to do 15, which is the base, and we're going to multiply it times the height, which is 5. And 15 times 5 is 75. And again, now we're going to find area. So area needs to be in meters squared. So that's how we found the area is 75 squared and the perimeter is 42. Now, the important thing when you do these things is that you need to make sure that everything is labeled, that you're careful and you're precise with your work. And that was a problem for school. So I'm glad that we got to do it on air tonight.
I said, hey, hey.
Here's a fun saying to help you remember the basic needs of the human body. Oh, can Venus flies make pretty webs? This actually helps you remember oxygen, carbohydrates, vitamins, fats, minerals, protein, water.
All right, so we have a winner in tonight's science challenge.
We do. Justin, are you there?
Yeah.
Hello, Justin. Justin, what are the names of these two lines that would represent our X and Y axis? Okay. Okay, the equator and the prime meridian is what I think I heard you saying. We don't have a great connection. So the equator would be the reference line that would be equivalent to the X-axis. That's our zero for our latitude lines. They're the ones that run east-west, but we measure north and south, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then the prime meridian would be our reference line for the longitude lines. Those are the ones that are vertical here that run north-south, but we measure east and west. Where would I be, Justin, if I was at that origin? Do you know where on the globe I would be? Near what continent?
Africa?
Yes,
yeah,
right.
Wow.
Right here off, where are we here? Here we are. Right off the coast of Africa here
so
would be that spot that's the
that's
origin.
That's 0-0.
That's 0-0.
Okay.
Okay. Justin, you know why the equator is where it is? Why do we call it the equator? Do you know?
Because it's the middle of the globe?
Actually, it's, yep, equidistant from the two poles. The mm-hmm. poles are the spot where that imaginary axis would pass through the Earth, so that's the equator. And the prime meridian is kind of arbitrary. That was put there by the British. They were the first one to make those maps. They had an observatory at Greenwich, England, and they had the prime meridian, or that zero, pass through their observatory.
So it goes all the way up to England, the prime meridian.
Yep, that what prime meridian goes pole to pole, but it happens to go right through Greenwich, England, where they have their had their observatory. Yeah.
Awesome.
So great job, Justin. Where do you go to school?
I'm Brooklyn and Chelsea.
All right. What grade are you in?
Seven.
Seven?
Wow, great
well,
job.
Good, Justin. You know your stuff. I hope your teacher's watching and gives you extra credit for that. All right. Congratulations, Justin. But now, don't forget, every correct response will go into our Hotline Hall of Fame. And if you earn enough points, you can win that tablet at the end of the season.
That's all the time we have for tonight. We are saying goodbye, but Dial Teachers available with free homework help on the phone until 7 o'clock tonight.
All right. Now, tune in on Monday for our Move to Include. Good night.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.